Hey, Haz and Chatham, my friends. Today, we're going to be sharing 7 potential treatment options for visual snow and visual snow syndrome. This will include some services provided by health professionals, but also some lifestyle modifications that you can try at home. Now, if you haven't seen the previous video that I did all about the different experiences and symptoms of visual snow syndrome and its diagnosis, then that is a video I highly encourage you to watch first. And if you haven't seen that, I'll put a link to it at the top of our show notes for you. Otherwise, for today's video, I'm super honored to be joined by Dr. Jaci Theis, who is residency trained in neurooptometry and binocular vision, otherwise known as ocular motor function or eye movement dysfunction. She's a practicing optometrist in a subspecialty clinic that sees mainly patients with visual dysfunction due to brain injury, neurological disease, as well as atypical development. And due to the nature of her practice, she has diagnosed and managed numerous cases of visual snow and visual snow syndrome. Hence why it is so special to have her on as a special guest. Now, before we dive in, it's important to note that visual snow syndrome is not yet fully understood. And while there are many different theories about what causes it, there's only a handful of studies really looking at it from a treatment perspective. And many of those treatments, the results are mixed.
In my opinion, based on literature and the numerous patients that I've seen, visual snow isn't one thing. It's more like a generalized neurologic symptom, similar to dizziness or headache. Therefore, to manage it properly, you need to find the underlying cause in order to treat the visual snow. Now, some people are born with visual snow and they have no clear trigger, while other people may acquire it after, for example, a brain injury or if they're suffering from seizures. Now, not all seizures cause visual snow, but there have been some case reports in the literature where people having visual snow are actually having that symptom because of underlying seizures.
And that's why it's essential to consult a local professional, whether that be a neurologist, an optometrist, or ophthalmologist, just to rule out that there's no other serious eye or neurological condition. And unfortunately, not every provider out there is familiar with visual snow syndrome, so it may take some persistence to find the right team of specialists. Now, it's important to note that for some people, visual snow may never fully go away. But the good news is that there are several strategies which can often reduce the intensity or frequency of symptoms. So let's talk about some options.
The first option that you may hear about from an optometrist is vision therapy, also known as orthoptics vision therapy or ocular motor vision therapy. So essentially an eye exercise program that is used to train the eyes to move together. If a patient with visual snow has ocular motor dysfunction, especially if their visual snow is tied to their ocular motor function, meaning specific visual tasks or eye movements trigger or aggravate their visual snow, then remediating the underlying ocular motor problem is a good treatment option for patients with visual snow. People with ocular motor dysfunction may also notice that they have difficulties with visual-related tasks, difficulties with endurance on things like computer or reading, they may have eye strain, double vision, or trouble with balance or depth perception. We know in patients with ocular motor dysfunction that targeted eye exercises can help with these abnormalities in eye coordination. What's interesting is one of the symptoms of visual snow, palynopsia, which happens when people see either an after image or a visual trail after a moving target, oftentimes improves when we train smooth pursuits. And there's some theories in the literature right now that the palynopsia symptom is due to abnormal smooth pursuits. So one thing that I always have to mention is that not all vision therapy is the same. As an optometrist who works with patients with eye movement dysfunction, I see a lot of patients who get a lot of great benefit from vision therapy, but not all vision therapy is the same. So do make sure that if you're seeking vision therapy, that you're working with somebody who does ocular motor rehab and is working with people who have eye movement dysfunction. If you go to see a provider and we don't see that you have an ocular motor dysfunction, then vision therapy is probably not going to fix any of your symptoms with visual snow. The second treatment option is to reduce your blue light and screen time exposure. Easier said than done. Many people with visual snow have noted that their symptoms can be exacerbated when they are exposed to extended computer use or electronic screens, as well as blue light sources like fluorescent lights or LEDs. Therefore, reducing screen time and blue light exposure can help mitigate symptoms for these patients. I usually recommend for patients that the first step is to use the device itself and whatever settings it has to reduce the blue light emission coming from the device itself. Studies have shown this to be the most effective way at reducing blue light emission from the electronics. Now, for some patients, this isn't enough for them to get relief from their electronics, and they feel that they also need specialty filtered lenses as well. Studies have looked into the blue light blockers that you can buy over the counter, and it's been interesting to see that the majority of them don't actually block all of the blue light coming from the devices. They only reduce maybe 20 to 30% of the blue light itself. So if you truly have a trigger for your visual snow symptoms from blue light, it is really important that you get a specialty notch filter that 100% filters out the blue light. Now keep in mind that frame choice matters too, because we know that blue light is going to be coming from the fluorescent lights as well as the LED lights, and you don't want to have a lot of the light still coming from the top or the sides of the frame triggering your symptoms.
Now at Dr. Theis's office, she has acquired a variety of different lenses and filters, such as FL41 filters and blue filters, for patients to try and see if any of them work for her patients. Now, if you've never heard of an FL41 filter before, while they look like just rose-colored glasses, right? They look kind of pinkish or red sometimes. It's important to note that they are distinctly different. It's not just any red-colored lens. An FL41 is technically a notch filter. It's a lens that selectively limits or removes a wavelength or several wavelengths of light that can be emitted from things like electronics or digital devices. Now, interestingly, while visual snow is distinctly different neurologically than migraine, many people who have a history of visual snow also tend to have a history of migraine as well. And they have shown in some publications that FL41 filters can help people who have a history of migraine with light sensitivity due to exposure of things like electronics as well as fluorescent lights.
Now, a few years ago, I started to notice that some of my migraine patients who are also highly sensitive to light emission from fluorescent lights, LEDs, and computers, to have very specific and different responses to FL41 filters. So I bought a plethora of FL41 filters for my office, and what I found was that every single patient had a different response, and there wasn't one FL41 that was the best option for one patient. One patient would like one lens, and one patient would like another. So being the clinician scientist that I am, I decided to do a study, and I used all of my filters with a spectrophotometer, and I looked at the spectral emission of those lenses and found that even though all of them were branded as an FL41, they didn't have the same emission profiles. And because photosensitivity, whether it's from visual snow or migraine or any other neurologic condition, can be very specific, that's why some patients will respond to one tint but not another. So I always tell my patients, if you've tried one FL41, you've tried one FL41. And therefore, if it didn't work for you, you might want to trial another. Another noteworthy thing that I found in my study was that the price of the lenses did not correlate with the effectiveness of the lenses, and it really was specific to the wavelength emission profile for what made a patient feel that their light sensitivity or their visual snow symptoms got better. And do know, not all patients respond to FL41 or blue light lenses either, neither the blue lenses that we've used in my office. So while I always tell patients we will give it a try, if it doesn't work, then we just have to find another treatment option to see what works for them.
So I actually have mentioned in previous videos that depending on my neck position or my posture, sometimes that can be a trigger for my migraines. And it's actually something I didn't know about in previous years. I actually learned about this connection from Dr. Theis at various eye care conventions when she gives lectures. So I wanted to ask her for this video if she could speak on if neck position and posture could perhaps lead to maybe triggering visual snow syndrome. And here's what she had to say.
So while it's not really well studied, the connection between the neck and the eyes is highly evident. I see this all the time in my clinic because we see such a plethora of patients with whiplash. And one of the things that we've started to notice is that there are some patients who notice that their visual snow symptoms actually get aggravated whenever they move their neck or their head in certain positions. So when I've had those patients who tell me that's their aggravator, go see an orthopedic physical therapist to work on their neck or their upper back. When those problems go away, all of a sudden they start to notice that their other symptoms go away. So yes, if symptoms worsen with certain head or neck positions, it is possible that your head or neck is the driver of your symptoms and you might notice benefit from orthopedic physical therapy. Treatment option number 4 is actually a lifestyle modification, and it's really easy to say and really hard to do. It's manage your stress and your sleep. We know that stress and poor sleep can affect brain function and worsen underlying neurologic conditions like visual snow and migraine. Sleep is essential to our well-being and our overall brain health. If someone's not sleeping, they're going to have a whole host of symptoms, including inattention, reduced mood, increased irritability, difficulty with visual focus. It can also make it harder for the eyes to coordinate together. While it's unlikely that stress and sleep are a primary cause for visual snow, in my opinion, I think that stress and sleep are a very big secondary cause or aggravator or exacerbator of visual snow. And if we're really looking at mitigating symptoms, we need to make sure that we mitigate all of the things that could potentially cause snow.
Number 5 is going to be to decrease caffeine and alcohol intake, or try to eliminate other potential trigger foods. It's known that some people with visual snow syndrome may be triggered by higher amounts of either caffeine intake or alcohol intake. Some people are just more sensitive. And some other conditions, things like migraine. Again, migraine is technically different from visual snow, but again, many people with visual snow tend to have a history of the migraine. And migraine is known to have many other food-like triggers, things like chocolate, wine, cheeses, and processed meats, for example. There's many out there. So some people who are sensitive may find a benefit of eliminating some of these foods and reducing their potential triggers and symptoms. Now, just wanted to add this here that there are some case reports of people's persistent visual snow symptoms developing or being triggered by the use of substances like marijuana or THC. Now, there is some debate whether that is truly a diagnosis of visual snow syndrome for those individuals, or it would be better classified as something like hallucinogen persisting perception disorder. Regardless, it's just important to know that there are case reports of people developing visual snow symptoms after use of some substances, such as alcohol, marijuana, LSD, etc. And it's been known to exacerbate or worsen symptoms for some people as well. Treatment number 6 is to ask a provider about trying medication.
Just like there is no single thing that can cause visual snow, there is no proven single medication that can treat visual snow. There have been numerous studies looking at the effectiveness of medications in treating visual snow, and all of them have mixed results, which is frustrating very much for providers because we don't know which one we should reach for. Some patients have benefits from an anticonvulsant, some patients have benefit from an antidepressant, some patients have no benefit, some patients have worsening of symptoms. And having this host of different results for patients with different medications makes it very difficult for medical providers to treat. Now, that being said, in the literature, there are some patients who do have great benefit from medications. And so, especially when lifestyle modifications aren't working, or if you're noticing that you've tried other options or you don't have any other underlying triggers, medication might be something that would work for you. As an optometrist who treats visual snow, it's not always within my scope to provide a medication that a patient is seeking for their visual snow, and sometimes it takes an entire medical team in order to treat someone's snow. For a patient who's not getting relief from any of the aforementioned options, sometimes we'll consider consulting with another medical provider to prescribe a medication. In my clinic, I usually try to encourage patients to seek a provider who will be treating another comorbidity they may have for their visual snow. What I mean by that, if you're a patient who has visual snow and migraines, let's start out with seeing if one of the treatment options that is shown to treat migraines and visual snow helps them. If the patient has anxiety, maybe we refer them to a psychiatry to see if treating their anxiety helps with their visual snow. That sometimes helps a little bit because I will say there is really no guidance in the literature for physicians as to which one is the best option for each patient. Before I pass the baton back to Dr. Allen, I do want to mention that sometimes many of my patients with visual snow actually have a multifactorial etiology, meaning they don't have just one thing causing their visual snow, or they have different parts of their visual snow that are caused by different things. And so sometimes patients need a multifactorial treatment option and multiple things in order to get their snow to go away. So do know that sometimes it's the combination of treatment options that really helps.
And then number 7 are supplements. For people who happen to be sensitive to light, maybe sensitive to glare, or have difficulty with night vision, then taking some supplements could be beneficial. There are supplements such as lutein, zeaxanthin, omega-3, and even turmeric that have been shown in some studies to help people with contrast sensitivity and with glare sensitivity. However, I do note that right now there's not a single supplement that has been shown to be effective specifically for visual snow, and it often takes around 6+ months of taking these types of supplements consistently before people report having improvements in these types of other symptoms. However, again, it may be something that could help. Now, if you are somebody who has visual snow syndrome or at least symptoms of visual snow, I hope that you can find a provider in your area, maybe try some of the different treatment options that we've listed out here, and that they will bring you some relief. But it's important to remember, like I mentioned early on in the video, that there are some people who, even trying everything, nothing brings resolution for their symptoms. So just something to keep in mind. Okay, so I know we covered a lot in this video, but I do want to first say thank you to not only you for watching, but to Dr. Theis for spending so much time with us and sharing her knowledge on this subject. I also want to encourage you to please let us know in the comments your favorite part of this video, like what your key takeaway was. And then from here, if you want to learn more about migraines, or if you want to learn more about FL41 filters, or maybe vitamins and supplements for eye health, then do check out our other videos that will include kind of in a mini series all about visual snow and kind of about information like this. Otherwise, I want to say thank you so much for joining us. I know it's just taken a little bit longer for us to get these videos together, to put everything out. And so I hope you guys find this valuable. Otherwise, again, thank you so much for watching. Keep an eye on it, and we'll see you in the future videos.